Well, we are currently in a series talking living victoriously. To kind of give you a recap of where we are, we have talked about that to live victoriously, we must realize that true victory only comes through Jesus and by his shed blood. And we may find some helpful hints in a book we read. We may find something, a good quote from a next door neighbor or something that was passed down from our grandfathers. But the truth is to live the victorious life, those things are only found in Jesus through his shed blood. Now, knowing what Jesus has done for us causes us to be grateful, knowing that our past has been dealt with. Last week, we talked about dealing with our past, but as we concluded the message, really kind of came to a conclusion that it's not our job to deal with our past as much as we need to realize that our past has been dealt with. And that is because of the work of Jesus on the cross. Now, this allows us to focus forward. You're starting to hear points from the previous weeks, hopefully. Or if you're one of those people who keep your bulletins from week to week to week, you're looking back and seeing that. But as you focus forward, you're going to realize that you're going to start walking this faith journey next to or alongside other people. And as you do, you'll realize that they're not as perfect as you are in the process. You ever realize that? It's a lot easier to look at someone and go, what were you thinking? Hoping they never look at you going, what are you thinking? The truth is, as we go through this faith journey, we're going to be surrounded by people and we're going to have those moments where we might step on their toes or they might step on our toes, but we're still focusing forward. We're still moving forward towards the mission and we need to not let that be a distraction. The truth is most of the time people are unaware when they step on your toes. They're unaware that they've hurt your feelings. Husbands and wives, have you ever had an argument and come to find out that maybe the other person in the marriage said, I had no idea, I'm sorry, or I didn't mean it that way. You ever heard those things before? In our family, my daughter and I, we always talk about how it's our tone. And she'll look at me and she'll say, Dad, your tone. And I'm like, I get it, because I can ask her to clean her room nicely, or I can ask her to clean her room not so nicely. And usually it's the not so nicely tone, maybe after the third or fourth time, but she'll look at me and say, Dad, tone, because I didn't realize I said that aggressively, so I'm sorry. And so she reminds me, Dad, your tone. So sometimes it's not what you say, it's how you can say it. But as you go through this journey, you rub people and they rub you the wrong way. And sometimes you rub others the wrong way. So how do we navigate these rough waters? How do we navigate this inevitable thing that we're probably going to end up in disagreement with someone? How do we navigate these rough waters that I want to be in unity with God, but yet I've got to walk alongside of other people and they're not as perfect as I am. And so how do I navigate that? Well, forgiveness is going to be part of the equation. Matter of fact, forgiveness is the answer to the equation. And I want us to look into Matthew chapter 18, starting in verse 21. Jesus gives a parable. He gives a story to answer a question that Peter asks. And it paints this really vivid picture for us. Now, you understand that we're not drawing doctrine out of this today. It's a story that Jesus tells to help give a point across. And so we look in Matthew 18, starting in verse 21. It says, then Peter came up and said to him, Lord, how often will my brother sin against me? I forgive him as many as seven times. Now I can imagine Peter, kind of what we know about Peter is I'm pretty sure he's like sitting around the disciples like, hey, watch this. Like Jesus is going to be so proud of me. Like I'm going to go ask him a question. I'm not going to have the answer. And he's going to be like, well done, Peter. And I'm going to be an example. Like he's probably thinking that in his head. And he walks up, he's like, Jesus, how many times my brother forgives me? Should I forgive him? What, seven times? And he's like, no. 70 times seven, a bunch more. And the point that Jesus is making is so many that you lose track of. See, we're really good at keeping count. We're really, really good at keeping score. But Jesus wants us to not keep the score. He goes on, he says this, I don't say you seven times, but 77 times. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle the accounts with his servants. When he began to settle one, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. And since he could not pay his master, He ordered him to be sold with his wife and his children and all that he had until the payment was made. So the servant fell on his knees, imploring of him, have patience with me and I will have everything. I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the master of the servant released him and forgave him of the debt. But when he saw the same servant went out and found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him, he began to choke him, saying, pay me what you owe. So his fellow servant fell down and pleaded with him. He says, have patience with me, and I will pay you. He refused and went and put him in prison until he should pay the debt. When the fellow servants saw this that taking place, they were greatly distressed, and they went and they reported to the master all that had taken place. Then the master summoned them and said, you wicked servant, I forgave you the debt that you pleaded with me, and you should not have the mercy of your fellow servant as I had mercy on you. And in anger, his master delivered him to the jailers until he should pay all of his debt. So also my heavenly Father will do every one of you if you do not forgive your brother from your heart. First thing we want to talk about today, if you're taking notes in the back of your bulletin, is that forgiveness is a continual thing. How often should you forgive your brother? Not 7 times. So many times that you lose count. Forgiveness is a continual thing. He says here in verse 21, how many times should I forgive him? As many times as it takes is another way to put it, I like. But we keep track. We say things like, this is the 3rd time this week. I get it, parents. You know, we want to teach a lesson. We want to get a point across. We want to understand that this is repeatable. We want to, you know, fix that and curb that. But when it comes to forgiveness, it's a continual thing. It's the 3rd time this week, which means it's the 3rd time that you're going to forgive. This is twice in the last 10 years. You're right. This is twice in the last 10 years that you were to forgive. Forgiveness is a continual thing. It's natural to keep score, but it's supernatural to forgive without limits. And that's the way we're called to forgive, is the way Jesus has forgiven us. I get it, it's natural. But we are called to live differently than what is normal. Aren't you glad that God doesn't have a threshold with us? Like, we don't reach the limit. Like, God's like, oh, you've overdrawn your account for the week. We're done. I'll never forget, first time I had a debit card, I was out with my friends hanging out one time, and I was like, we go by the ATM. It was pretty cool. Like, I thought it was really neat. I had this little piece of plastic, you know, I'm like 17 years old, whatever. I go to this little machine that's usually attached to like a building, and it charges you money to get your money out. I thought that was pretty cool. And so I was like, I got my money out. And then like the next day I was out with some friends, I was outside our bank, and I was like, let me get some more money. I used my ATM card, and it was like insufficient funds. I was like, what does that mean? I put it in there, hit my code again, insufficient funds. I'm like, what in the world? So I walk in the bank, go talk to Peggy, the lady who worked at her bank there in White Right. I was like, Miss Peggy, my card's not working. I tried to get some money at ATM. She's like, well, honey, what did it say? I said, it said insufficient funds. What does that mean? She's like, well, honey, that means you don't have enough money to take out. You have to put money in order to take money out. And you can only take as much money as you put in. I mean, it's a novel concept. You're probably thinking, man, this guy's not the sharpest spoon in the drawer. I didn't know how the ATM thing worked. I knew a check, you just write as many of those as you want growing up. That's why I was always told my mom, just write a check. She's like, not that easy. I'm like, I see you do it all the time. And I don't understand. But like I said, it was a novel concept for me at the time. So she explained to me, and I was like, okay, I get it. You know, I wasn't that dense. But that thing stuck with me. You can only take out that's what you put in. Aren't you glad today that God doesn't work that way? That he didn't show up today going, oh, Paul, I see. What are you requesting? Well, let's see what you put in so far. Oh, sorry, insufficient funds. Moving next. The God has rich mercy and his grace and his love for us. He says, I'll give you what you don't deserve. I'll die for you while you're still a sinner. That's how much I love you. And aren't we glad that God doesn't operate the way we operate sometimes, that he doesn't keep score, that he takes our sin and he remembers it no more. that when God looks at us, he sees us clothed in the righteousness of Christ, not because of things that I've done or have earned or received, but simply because of the grace and the love and the sacrifice of Jesus. Victory is found through Jesus and his shed blood and nothing else. Church, today, we should be grateful that God doesn't operate in the forgiveness realm as many of us have or sometimes do. So you say, okay, Paul, so how am I supposed to forgive? I get it how God does it. I receive it. I understand it. I like it. I enjoy it. I need it every single day. So what's my response into this? Well, Colossians 3:13, it's not on the screen for you. It says this. Paul writes this, bear with one another. And if one has a complaint against another, forgive each other. As the Lord has forgiven you, so you must also forgive. Two huge things in there. He says, once, bear with one another. And if someone's got a complaint against you, someone's ever complained about you? No? Try being a pastor sometime. There's always a complaint. Someone's always got something, you know, in life that, you know, you're driving too fast, you're driving too slow, you left the garage door up, you left the refrigerator door open, you got the big forks and the small forks mixed up in the drawer. Someone's always gonna have a complaint against some of you, some of us. He says, as someone has a complaint against you, you must forgive each other. Forgive each other. As the Lord has forgiven you, you must also forgive. So I have to ask myself this question. Okay, if I get it, when someone's got a complaint against me, I'm to forgive them as God has forgiven me. I like to say it this way. How has God forgiven me? Two things, immediately and continually. Immediately and continually. I've yet to ever get a busy signal when calling upon God and saying, you know what, Paul, this is twice this week. I have to think this one over. The problem is many of us probably don't approach God correctly when it comes to our sin. We'll get to that in a second point here in a second. But continually and immediately. When I come before God Almighty and repent of my sin, God does not pout, look up. He's already in heaven, so I can't say look up in the heavens because he's there. But just say, he just kind of turns his head and goes, I have to think about it. I get it. When we interact with each other, there's painful things. And the hurt is very real. But I promise you, the sin that put Jesus on the cross was very real too. I'm not saying it's natural. I'm telling you, these are supernatural things that God is asking us to participate in with him on. We are to forgive continually and immediately, just as the Lord's forgiven us. Ephesians 4:32 says, be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you. My response is, someone's got an offense, we work it out, we forgive each other as God has forgiven me. If I'm to be kind to one another, tenderhearted, and I'm going to forgive just as God in Christ forgave me. This goes with from parent to kid, kid to parent, husband to wife, mom to dad, in-law to in-law, in-law to outlaw, coworker to boss. Doesn't matter, any relationship you can imagine, this as a response, as a Christ living in us, this is our appropriate response. And there it is again, you find out where it says, forgive as forgiven. Forgiveness is continual. But we got to realize that this may seem kind of elementary. This may seem kind of vanilla. Like, I get it, as a Christian, God forgave me, I'm going to forgive other people. But the thing is, really, inside the church, as Christians, we do a terrible job of this. We really do. And I'm not here to point fingers as much as I'm pointing fingers back at myself. But when someone offends us, you know what we don't do? We don't go to that person. We sit in a group with other people and we let other people rally on our side to tell us that they should agree with our offense. Did you understand? I was there and they totally ignored me. It's the second time this week. And then we tell that person, then we tell this person, and we tell this person, we tell that person. Listen, if that person has offended you, forgive them. Do you realize that person probably doesn't even realize they offended you? You ever walked into that? You ever done the wrong thing and didn't realize you did the wrong thing? By the time you get there, the house is on fire and everything's caving in. You're like, whoa, if we'd have talked about this 2 weeks ago, we could have avoided a lot of this stuff. Sometimes you don't even need to go to that person because they have no idea they offended you. Just say, you know what, God, what they said or how they said it, it hurt me. And I want to believe the best about my brother or my sister in Christ. And I know that their intent is not to go out and hurt people by what they say. So God, I want to release them from my heart. I just want to say, I forgive them, Lord. I know I love them. I believe the best about them. So help me not harbor anger or bitterness or frustration towards those people. And then if that doesn't work, you might need to go to them and say, you know what? You don't realize this, but 2 weeks ago you said this. And because of the week I had, it just didn't settle right. And in my heart, me and you were not like this. And it allowed me to think some things and say some things that were hurtful. And I want you to know that I love you and I'm sorry for what had happened to me. And maybe even give them a chance to say, you know what? I had no idea. I'm sorry too. You know, in that moment, it says more about the person who was offended than the person who was doing the offending. So forgiveness is a continual thing. And the other thing about forgiveness, it's more about the heart than the words that are being said. When we forgive, it's not a lip service. I've shared this to you before. I had a deacon at our old church growing up, and he would pray for the offertory prayer. And I thought it was the coolest thing in the world. He was like, Lord, for all of us gathered here today, forgive us when we fail thee. In your name we pray. Amen. And I was like, this guy just forgave my sins because he prayed that everyone in this room, that God would forgive their sins as we fail them. I'm like, I'm good now. Like, thanks, Brother Larry. Like, I was like, this is so cool. He just prayed for everyone that for God would forgive, make everyone like, and as I grow older, I thought, where's the repentance in my heart for this? And then I got to thinking, as I got a little more older, a little more mature, I thought, where's the remorse? Where's the heart behind the repentance? It's almost like bringing my wife to the point of tears and going, sorry. I don't know if you've tried that, guys, but that's not the right hand motion or the right tone in the moment. Little marriage tip for you guys. That's the wrong thing to do, okay? I read it somewhere. I've never done it. But forgiveness is about the heart. It's not about the words. Look at verse 26. Listen to how this guy responds when he finds out that he's fixing to have to pay the debt. We're going to arrest your wife. We're going to arrest your kids. We're going to throw you in jail until everything's taken care of. This guy, look at his response in verse 26. He says, so the servant fell on his knees imploring him, have patience with me. Fell on his knees and imploring. The falling on his knees is a sign of submission or reverence. The imploring, the begging, or being desperate is a sign of great emotion. When's the last time we walked into our prayer closet or sat at our kitchen table and we implored before God Almighty that he'd forgive us, that he'd create a clean heart within us, that we're sorry for the words we said, the attitude we had last week at work, the attitude we had when we brought back before our kids, like that we go before God and we are absolutely torn apart because of what we said or what we did was contrary to the calling of Christ in our lives. Instead, we just say things like, Lord, thanks for today. Forgive me when I fail you. Amen. It's no different looking at your wife going, hey, if I upset you, I'm sorry about it. It would never fly in your marriage. And church, I want you to know it doesn't fly in your walk with God. We need to take what Jesus did on the cross seriously and be and absolutely go before him and say, Lord, I know that you died for me while I was still a sinner. That's how much you love me. And the fact that I could just go out and say these things or do these things or think these things or say, be around these people and participate in this activity or this activity and not even blink an eye. God, I want you to know that I'm sorry for that. You've called me to a higher standard. You've given me instruction through your word, which I've ignored. And God, I want you to know that I'm sorry for this. Where is that in our lives? Maybe it's there. I hope so. But most of us, it seems like we just kind of check the box and we're moving on. There's brokenness when we pray. We're a little reminded in Luke 18 where the Pharisee and the tax collector is praying, and the Pharisee's like, I'm just so glad I'm not like this guy. Man, couldn't be like that. Thanks, God. Thank you for loving me. Amen. And this tax collector literally standing over the corner away from other people is beating his chest. Just like, beating it. And he's like, God, have mercy on me. I'm a sinner. Man, he's a tax collector. He's probably stolen from people. He's a scum of society. People look down on him. They avoid him. But yet he knows who he needs to go to. Just have mercy on me. A sinner. All by himself. And God says, that's the way I want you to pray. That's the man that I'm listening to. You know what? Going back to the whole, it's not what you say, it's kind of how you say it. That's why I don't offer a blanket salvation prayer at the end of the church service. I don't stand before a church and say, everybody stand with me and say these words. Because if I stood up and said, hey, everybody repeat with me, I love broccoli. And everybody said, I love broccoli. And then I said, and I hate chocolate. And I hate chocolate. And I said, raise your hand if you meant that. I'd be very shocked if anyone had raised their hand. I love broccoli over chocolate. There's probably very few people in here that do. If you know, we will be praying for you. But just because you said it doesn't mean you meant it. And as a pastor, if I stood up in the service and said, say these words after me, and everyone said it, and then I said, amen. I'm like, if you prayed that prayer for the first time, you're in heaven, you'll be in heaven when you die. Just because you said it doesn't mean you meant it. Here I am as a pastor giving you assurance that you'll be in heaven one day because you repeated the words that I repeated. I gotta be very careful as a pastor to give anyone assurance of anything that I don't know for myself. So the reason why we do our invitations, what we do, where people come down so we can have a talk with people. That last week, one of our deacons spent 25 minutes after a service mentoring and talking with a couple in our church. Be glad we didn't hold you hostage until they were done, until we were singing the last verse of Just As I Am for you to go to lunch. But yeah, we had an unlimited amount of time after church to meet with these people, to talk, to ask questions, to respond, to listen, to pray, to search, to read scripture. And I got to be very careful as a pastor to give someone assurance on something I have no idea. I've never met you, and I might not ever meet you, but because I'm a pastor and I stand before you and I hold a Bible in front of me and you were looking for help, I just gave you false assurance. So church, that's why we don't do our invitations a certain way, and that's why we do our invitations a certain way, because we want to talk with you. I don't want to just stand up and have you repeat something and send you on your way, having no recollection of who you are, setting you up with someone who can disciple you, someone who becomes a brand new Christian, where you're gonna send them out the door, not even know who they are, not have a chance to meet them up and have go through life coach or disciple them. It's more about what you say, it's about your heart. So you can say, I'm sorry all day long. You can say, I love Jesus, but if your heart isn't meaning it, they're empty words. Now, the other thing about forgiveness we need to know, not only does forgiveness continue, it's more about your heart than the words. The last thing is we need to forgive because we've been forgiven. We forgive because we have been forgiven. If you're holding something against someone else, forgive them as you've been forgiven, immediately and continually. Forgive them doesn't say that what you did was okay. God doesn't say that. When I go before God and say, God, I'm sorry for the things I said, for the things I thought. God, I'm sorry for the way I acted, my reaction towards that person. Lord, I just want to come to you and I just want to confess that. God doesn't condone the behavior, but he forgives me. He restores me. So forgiving someone in our past or in our present isn't saying what you did was okay. What it is you're partnering in with God and doing what he has also done for you. And many times what we do is we let them say, this is the offense, and we want to watch them and dangle the carrot and say, I'll forgive you once I feel like it. And then we'll dangle the carrot till they get here and they're like, okay, you've earned my trust again, I'll forgive you. Instead of dangling a carrot and use that as a manipulation factor, like, I'll forgive you when, God says, I'll tell you what, I'll forgive you so that he opens the gate to freedom instead of using it to manipulate us until we feel like it's okay. So church, I don't know your story, and I'm kind of glad I don't know everyone's story in person, because that kind of makes it a little easier for me to say these things. But I get it. Many of us have been hurt. We've been hurt by past relationships, past marriages, bosses, our own children sometimes, our parents. I get it. But to wait till they've done certain things in your mind to approve themselves worthy of forgiveness is contrary to what God has done for us in our lives. And we are to forgive as Christ has forgiven us. And you releasing that person saying, God, I want to love them again. I want to forgive them and trust you with everything else. It says more about your walk with God than it does about their offense. We forgive because we've been forgiven. And what better way to show grace and mercy and the love of Jesus by allowing someone else to receive something that they don't deserve? I'm not saying what you said to me or to my wife or to my kids was okay, but I forgive you anyways. What better way to show them what Jesus has done for you than to demonstrate the same thing back towards them? By doing this, we will walk in victory. When someone brings up your past, yeah, it might hurt, but you've released that. I'm not bound by that person's actions anymore. God has redeemed me. He's made me whole. He's dealt with my past, and I have forgiven those. And I can truly walk in victory because victory is found in what Jesus did and through the blood shed. And he's forgiven me, and I'm going to forgive others because forgiveness is a continual thing. It's more about the heart than the words. As a matter of fact, can you imagine? You've probably seen this happen where you've seen two people who kind of been arguing, maybe it's a husband or wife, and they look at each other, kind of take a deep breath, they walk over and they give each other a hug, maybe some tears shed, and they kind of separate and they're like, love you too. Not one word was said about forgive me, I'm sorry, forgive me for this, but forgiveness took place. It's more about the heart than the words. And simply we do this and we're called to do this because it was done for us. Church, we shouldn't be the people who have been forgiven of this immeasurable debt, being separated from God forever, and yet hold someone captive because they said something in the wrong tone, because they didn't do something we liked, because we don't agree with their decision-making. My sin put Jesus on the cross. There's caused me to be in a bad mood for the last 2 days. If God will forgive us of our debt, we must also forgive us of other people's debts. You've heard me say this before, that hurt people hurt people. The reason why they said those mean things because they're hurting, so hurt people hurt people. Well, church, I want you to know something else today is that forgiven people forgive people. I'm not telling you it's easy. And I'm not gonna tell you it's not gonna be a long road. I can only tell you that it's worth it, because the word of God commands us to. So if you're sitting here today and you're like, Paul, I don't know what that looks like. I've tried to have this conversation with my son-in-law before. I've tried this conversation with my wife before, and it hasn't worked out. Then at the end of the service, we've got some deacons. Their wives will be down here. Some of our staff will be down here. We want to pray with you. We just want to hear your story and partner with you in prayer or follow up and have a coffee or lunch sometime and walk with you through this. We want to spend some time investing ourselves in you and your story. If you're sitting here today and you're like, you know what? This is the church I want to be a part of. I've been here for the last 6 years and I'm ready to join. Or maybe you've been here for the last 60 minutes. You're like, this is it. I'm ready to join. Then after the church service, we'd love to talk to you, tell you when our next Bulverde Basics class is and how you can join. Or maybe you're sitting here today and you're like, you know what? I've never been baptized. I've put it off. I know Jesus in my life, but I've never taken that next step. It was when I was at a youth camp and I've never followed through with baptism. In a minute, we're going to get to watch Harrison, young kid in our church, who says, I am trusting Jesus with my life. And my first step of obedience is going to be being baptized. This will be an awesome time to celebrate. Church, I don't know where you're at, what's on your heart. But I can tell you, if something's weighing on you, to walk out those back doors would be the worst thing you could do. But just telling someone and saying, hey, I don't know where I'm at, but just need some prayer. We're here for you. We'd love to partner with you that. Let me close in a word of prayer and then we'll have some a baptism. Lord, I pray as we leave today that we would not leave with a heavy heart, but we would leave being relieved, knowing that you have taken away the burden, the penalty of our sin. If we don't know you, let us talk to someone about what it means to know Jesus, to know you as our Father, as our Savior. Church, thank you for being a wonderful church. God, thank you for Bulverde Baptist Church, the members that are here. And we don't find ourselves in quarrel. We don't find ourselves fighting at business meetings. God, thank you for the spirit of unity, and thank you for the spirit of friendliness that we've allowed to continue to see flow throughout Bulverde Baptist Church. We just pray that we would be able to take it and share it with other people. That we would take the forgiveness that we've received and walk in forgiveness with other people. Thank you, Jesus, for all you've done. Amen. Let's watch this video real quick.
My name is Harrison Moran, and I've been coming to Bulverde Baptist Church for 3 years. When Pastor Paul was preaching about Jesus dying on the cross, I knew I wanted to follow him.
Why specifically do you want to be baptized today?
He died on the cross for me.
You believe him?
Harrison is a ball of energy until you put a video camera in front of him. I think mom and dad finally figured it out. If we ever need him to sit still, we'll just videotape him. Harrison, you believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins? And you believe that God lives in your life and you've got eternal life? Yes. Then it's your privilege for your dad to baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Church, let's stand to our feet. There's so much to be grateful for, so much to be thankful for. If there's anything we can do for you, at the end of the service, we'll be down here at the front to pray with you, to meet with you. I know you don't see anyone right now. That's because we kind of transitioned to the prayer. Don't give us 10 seconds. We'll be here. You're dismissed. Have a wonderful Sunday. Don't forget, hang around for our business meeting, which will start in about 6 minutes.